Plain old office supplies, when cut from watercolor paper, become the jumping off point for all kinds of creative projects. In today's video, I'll show you how to transform watercolor index cards into a perfect bound journal. I'll also demo several techniques for adding color and pattern to the cards using ink sprays, paint, and a gel press plate. I'm going to begin by showing you how to combine single index cards into a perfect bound journal. Then I'll back up and we'll look at page and background techniques. So perfect bindings are what you're accustomed to seeing in things like magazines and other mass market publications. It's an easy way to bind those single sheets without needing to stitch or make any holes. And the key to this is to use a glue that will flex when it's dry. If it cracks, the binding is likely to fail, so it's important that you use the correct kind of glue. PVA works really well, but you can also use something like the Aliens, the super thick tacky glue, because it will flex when it dries. So the first step is to take your pages. Now, obviously, the thing with this journal is that it's these 5x7 index cards that I've done a variety of things to, and I'm bringing in addition to selling the index cards, we also sell tabbed dividers. So if you can imagine this in some sort of a file box, you have the tab dividers, but we're going to make that one better by assembling all of these into a journal. So the kit, it will include 12 of the 5x7 index cards, 3 of the tab dividers, one in each of the 3 positions, and then it's going to include a couple of covers that are long enough so that when they are on this journal, you can see that the cover is going to extend just beyond that first tab position so that it actually conceals everything that's inside. What I'm going to do is put this together. Now, it's important when you do this that you want to have the back of this, these pages and tabbed dividers, all need to be tamped down correctly to the back, and you want to have this as even as possible. And then what I like to do is use binder clips. Now, I'm going to grab a couple of these, happen to be art girls' dresses because they're what's around. Since I'm going to glue the back of the binding, what I'm going to do is use these here so that the binder clips, which are really strong, don't damage the actual paper itself that is the covers. So I'll put that on there like that. And then I'm going to come around. I just want to make certain that this still feels correct. I'm going to grab 2 more of the art girls' dresses because they're what I have handy. Just stick them on here and whoops. Put another binder clip on so that everything is held really securely. So this now is the spine of the book. And I will probably, once I get the glue on this, I'm going to come back and I'll put another clip over the top here, but obviously I can't do that for now. When I do this, I'm going to use, this is kind of a stiff, slightly stiff bristle brush. I'm going to spread the adhesive on with this brush so that I can get it not just on the back of the index cards or what is the spine, but I want just the tiniest bit to creep down inside, which is another reason it's good that this isn't clamped right away, and I'll clamp it after the fact. So when I do this, I always do 3 coats, but the key is that you have to let the coats dry in between. So I'm just going to hold this, and you can see that this is it. I mean, there's nothing special going on here other than the fact that you have to be certain that you get the adhesive on the back of every single sheet that's on here. You want them to all be glued in tightly together. And obviously I have this one page that's bulging out, or a couple of them, but once I put a binder clip on the top, that will be resolved. And it's just a matter of going along the length of the entire spine. Now, if you get a little bit of glue around that front or back edge, it's not going to matter, at least not for the technique that I'm going to use, because I'm going to wrap the spine, and I'll show you that. I have a block of index cards in a smaller size all glued up and ready to go. So once I get this first coat on here, I'll show you what I mean. So that looks pretty good. So I will let this dry completely. Once I get this smoothed out, I'm going to let this dry completely, and then I'm going to come back and add a second coat, let it dry completely, and then I'll add a third. I'm just going to wipe that up because there will be no wrap right there. All right, so I'm going to just put that in some water for now. I'm going to put this over here, and I will clamp it afterward. I have a couple of minutes. So wiping the glue off of my fingers. When you wrap the spine, you're going to cut, this is Ranger's Sticky Back Canvas. So it has adhesive on the back, and of course I'm all thumbs, but you'll peel this off, there we go, like this, to expose the shiny side, which is where the adhesive is. Now I'm going to supplement that with some of the tacky glue because I don't want this to lift, and obviously something that's going to get flexed like this will also cause some flexing here, and I don't, like I said, I don't want the adhesive to be compromised. So when you decide how tall this needs to be, it is the height of the pages of your journal or your index cards. These happen to be 3x5s. When you think about how wide to make it, you need to accommodate the width, or the height, if you will, of this binding. Height as you look at it, but when it's this way, it's the width. And however much you want to wrap around each side. So what I've done is I cut this, I think, a little bit over 2 inches. And if I just kind of imagine this going on here, you can see that it's going to wrap something a little bit like this. Now, obviously, for my journal, I'm going to paint this. I haven't done anything yet, but I'm going to paint mine to coordinate with what's on the covers. For this, it really doesn't make any difference because it's just a demo thing. All right, so let's peel this backing paper off. Well, there go my all thumbs again. All right, so I'm going to use, I stuck that brush in water, so I'm going to use a toothpick. What I want to do is get a line of adhesive down the height of this, or the length of it. Again, it kind of depends on which way you have it turned. All right, that's enough. Let's just wipe this up. Put that to one side. And now what I want to do is, visually, I'm just going to eyeball this. I want it to be aligned top to bottom so that this is on there. Now you can see that that's uneven, so I'm going to slide this so that it is in fact centered, so that the wrap ends up being the same on both sides. Now you have some time to work. This glue does not dry super fast, so having some time to work is a good thing. I'm going to come back and pick this up. Now I'm not going to do a super good job here. For the sake of argument, I want to show you how I'm doing this, but I'm not going to spend the time to be certain that I have adhesive. I have this glue on every little piece because this is a prototype that I'm not actually going to do anything with after the fact. So what you'll do is get some adhesive on the entire section here, wrap it over, gently bring it around. Now this will stretch if you push on it too hard, so you want to be gentle and just get that on there so it's aligned properly, and then come around and do the same thing on this side. The time-consuming part of this, the fun part of this, besides, you know, making a book, is the all of the effort, all of the things that you do to create all of those pages, those index cards. So to come back to the kit for 1 second, we will have a kit available in a 5x7 size. It will include 12 of the 5x7 index cards, as I said, one each of the three positions of the tabs, the tab dividers, and then those two covers. So all you'll need to do is go for it and work on your pages. Now having said that, 12 index cards is not going to give you a journal as thick as this. If you want to add more, all you have to do is buy a couple of packages of the 5x7 index cards. They're identical to what's in the kit, and then you'll be good to go. So I've got a little bit of oozing going on here. I put a little bit too much glue on. Again, this is a prototype that I'm not spending a lot of time being careful with, but that's it. Once this is dry, you'll be able, well, you can open it up now, but you can see that you can open this up. You have all these pages. You have the tab dividers that you can use to arrange your pages or your index cards in some order. But this is it. This is how simple it is to just go ahead and take those index cards and bind them into something that is a journal like this. Now this one does not happen to have the covers on it. I didn't cut covers for this one. Nothing says you have to if you want to just leave those tabs sticking out like that. So up next there's going to be a couple of segments that I will show you a variety of ways that you can add color and pattern to the index cards. Before I send you on to the page and background techniques, I wanted to show you, just quickly flip through my finished journal, and I wanted to tell you about something that I did not do a particularly good job of, but I want to show you what happens and how to resolve it. So front cover, back cover, the spine wrap, everything is in place. As I said, I was going to add color to my sticky back canvas, and I did. So as I start to page through here, you can see, whoops, I got a little lift there. We're going to talk about that in 1 second. You can see that some of these pages are done. Some of them are not. They're in various degrees of completion, which is going to allow me to finish them as I get time. So the thing that I did not do a good job of, when I demonstrated for you how I was putting the adhesive on the spine, I did not do a good job. And that happens sometimes when I'm doing things on camera. I'm trying to show you without necessarily taking all the care that I normally would. So in comes, this is Dina Wakely's, let me turn this way. This is Dina Wakely's, well, there we go. We'll try a piece that's not all tangled up. This is Dina Wakely's washi tape. This is, I forget, maybe a quarter of an inch wide. It's the blank tape. The nice thing about this is how translucent it is. So you can see that I'm going to put this in here. It's going to hold that page in place. And then all I need to do is grab a little pair of scissors and go ahead and trim off the excess. So, first of all, to clear up a misconception, I do not do things perfectly all the time. I know it might seem that way because it's pretty rare that I have an opportunity to show you mistakes like this. They happen. So, as you page through, again, you can see we have a tab here. This page is almost done. I might come in with some white Posca pen and do something there. I like this one. I think I'm going to leave that one alone. But anyway, I have my three tabs. They have sectioned this off into various areas. You can see that there's all kinds of different things going on here. Sometimes it only takes dots with a white Posca paint pen to create something really interesting like this. So make your journal, transform those 5x7 index cards into something wonderful. Page techniques for this journal include printing on a gel press plate, using a brayer without the plate and adding blocks of color, working with gel medium as a resist, then adding color with sprays, and finger painting on an index card that has been gessoed. So this whole project came about because I was playing with various products on a gel press plate and I was printing on index cards. If you watched the video from a couple of weeks ago where I demo techniques with Finnebert's icing paste, you may well remember some of these index cards from that one. There's a ton of techniques that you can use for printing on a gel press plate. I'm just going to show you a couple of quick ones that come together to make a really interesting little print. It's not going to be the same thing over the whole index card, and that'll make sense in a second. So Dina Wakely's paint, I have eggplant and night and turquoise. My base layer, whoops, is going to be turquoise. So I'm just going to brayer enough out here. I'm not going to cover the whole plate. I'm just going to work with one index card, which means I don't need to cover the whole plate. So these paints are pretty opaque. I'm going to put this down and I should get reasonably close to full coverage. Off to the side, I have something where some scratch paper where I can roll off the excess color. So I'm just going to put this down, grab some scratch paper, and then go ahead and print it. Now ordinarily, you're going to see me clean the plate. Ordinarily, I would not do that, but I don't want to muddy the waters here. So there is my background, pretty turquoise. I'm just going to use a little bit of water because there's a fair amount of paint on here. Ordinarily, I would have printed a ghost print or pulled a ghost print, but again, for the sake of brevity, I'm not going to do that here now. Let's grab some paper towel. Okay, close enough. So the next thing I'm going to do is pick up some of the eggplant, and I'm going to use our endless stencil, and I'm going to print what remains from the stencil after I get through, well, of course it's tangled, after I get through pulling the color through the openings. So I'm going to stand here for 1 second and disentangle the elements from that endless stencil. All right, so let's, well, we've got a little bit of turquoise on there still, but that'll just make things more interesting. Same process, I want to brayer that out, roll off the excess, and here comes the stencil. So this is our endless stencil. This is one of the first designs that we came out with way back in 2013, I think it was, when we started the first time with stencils. So I'm going to use a piece of scratch paper, and I want to pull as much of that paint through the openings of the stencil as possible. So I'm actually going to do it a second time, and that will help me get lots of the paint out, which will allow more of that turquoise background to show. All right, that looks pretty good. So let's just put that to one side. Rather than print the whole thing, I'm going to print, well, let's do it this way. Well, no, let's do it this way. I'm going to print about 2/3 of this. So I'm just going to place it down, grab yet another piece of scratch paper so that I get good contact between the index card and the plate, and obviously I take off that excess color. And there's my pattern. It's exactly what I was looking for. I can see the design from the stencil. I have a different color, but that background is very visible. Again, I'm just going to quickly give this a wipe. If I were working here in my studio, well, that's not working. I would just keep going and going and going, and eventually I would have paint everywhere, but you get this kind of debris that happens that you pick up, and that's how you end up with things that look like this. But that's a subject for a different video. So I'm going to come back with the night, and this time rather than pull the paint through the openings of the stencil on a piece of scratch paper, I'm going to do it right on the index card. So what I'm trying to accomplish, because the next stencil that I've chosen has a pretty bold design on it, what I want to do is have as much of that design show as possible, and I want it to be bold. So this is Marrakesh. I'm going to lay that down on there, and as I said, I'm not going to pull the color through the openings of the stencil. Instead, what I'm going to do, I'm not going to pull it with scratch paper. Instead, what I'm going to do is put it on and print it like this, so I get that bold design rather than pulling the color through and then printing like I did to get the endless one. All right, so then, see how cool is that? You get that really sharp line between the two colors. Now, I did get a little bit of overlap. That's really easy to fix. A lot of times I'll come in, so Posca makes these ginormous. This is a PC-17K. This is 15 millimeters, so it makes, you can see, it's huge. It makes a really wide line, and I can put that on here to divide this up. So you can see how easy this is. Let's go ahead and start moving some stuff out of the way because things are now accumulating. I'm going to get the plate out of the way, and then I'm going to show you the next paint technique, which is just, yeah, that's gone, which is just brayering color on to an index card. My goodness, I am just covered in stuff here. It's brayering color on and seeing what happens. All right, so I have this background. This is done with Lindy's. Now, this technique you can do if you want on something that is plain. You just grab a new card or the back of one that's still plain, and you can go to town on it. But having said that, what I'm going to do instead is just grab some colors. And you know what? Let's come back with the eggplant because it's a good color for this. I'm going to squeeze some out here. Now, what I need to do is make certain that my brayer is reasonably clean. And I'm not going to over-brayer this. I don't want to spread this around. You can see that there are areas on my brayer that don't have any color, and that's exactly what I'm looking for. It allows me to get this kind of blocky look. And the only way I know how to do this is to do it like this. So now I have my design, that's what there is of it, the background, is started to get pushed into the background because I've layered this color over the top. Now, when you do this, you are not limited to just brayering it on. I'm just going to grab another piece. If you want to come back, whoops, that was a mess, but if you want to come back and print what's left on whatever it is that you're applying the paint to with the brayer, you can certainly do that, and this is the start of something entirely different. So then the last thing that I want to show you is, let's bring in gesso, and I need to clean this up. We're going to do this finger painting thing that I enjoy so much, and it's a technique that I employ quite a lot, actually. So I have two index cards that were just very roughly gessoed, and I'm going to show you how I do that. So here is one. I'm going to grab some gesso and a palette knife. When I do this, I don't want full coverage. I don't want anything resembling full coverage. I just want this to be thick and thin. I want it to go on however it goes on. Sometimes it runs off the edge of the card. Sometimes it doesn't, and this leaves big gapes and open spaces. That's exactly what I want. The whole purpose of that is that the paint is going to cling to the gesso quite differently than it will, well, that's a mess, quite differently than it will to the areas where there isn't any. It's going to grab right onto the raw paper, and it's going to slip a little bit on the gesso. So, wiping my fingers. This one is already done. I put some gesso on here earlier, and it's all dry. So now I'm going to come back with cheddar. This is olive, and I think I'll use eggplant because I think it's going to be a fun contrast. I'm just going to put a little bit out on here. remembering now that I can combine the combine the cheddar and the eggplant and I'll get some kind of an orangey mix. But what I don't want to do is blend the olive with the eggplant because I'm going to get mud. So I'm going to leave the olive to last. And when I do this, I like to just come and spread the color around and you can see what happens. Let's come over here and do a little bit more. Where there isn't any gesso, see right here? See how the color looks different? That's automatic. It happens. You don't even have to think about it. It simply happens because the gesso is acting as Dina Wakely says, underwear for your paint. So what that means is that things slip around and it doesn't cling the way that it would to the areas where the areas of the paper rather where there isn't any. All right, so I put out way too much paint, but what I'm going to do now is come back with a little bit of the olive and just put some on there. You know what? That might not be enough contrast. Maybe I'll do some of this and I'll come back. Yeah, it's not. Let's come back with some of the night. That'll work even better because there's a nice strong contrast. So this is, honestly, this is how simple it is. And once this is dry, the paint is permanent, so I can come back over it and I can spray and nothing is going to change. Or if I want to get, you know, a little bit daring and crazy, what I could do is make a giant mess. What I could do would be to grab a spray. This is a Lindy Starburst spray. I love, obviously, all the glimmer that's in here. And if I want to put a little bit on, I can do that too. And now I've got an entirely different look. Once this dries, I've got these areas where it spit. I've got the glimmer. So you get some really interesting effects. You can do as much of this or as little of this, or any or all of these things as you go along. And it becomes either the surface that you're going to put whatever else on. You could write on here. You could collage some things on it. Or it becomes a beginning or intermediate layer waiting for more. The last thing I'm going to show you today is using gel medium as a resist, and I'm going to show you a couple of different ways to apply the gel medium because how you do it will affect the outcome. So both of these pages have had gel medium applied using a mini ink blending tool through the openings of a stencil. Now here, I can see it if the light hits it just right, but you're probably not going to see that much of it. Here, because the stencil was dirty, the gel medium picked up some of the spray that was on there, and what ordinarily would have been white, because that's what the gel medium would have masked off, much like what I did here, is colored by whatever those colors were. If you look at this, and you can really see the reflection, this was gel medium applied through a stencil. It's a much thicker layer, and it's going to provide much more coverage in terms of a resist. When I spray these, and I'm going to start with this one, you will see, actually, before I spray anything, let me show you the process. But when you spray this, you'll see that the gel medium, because it's not on there in a perfect layer, is not going to act as a perfect resist. So, for example, let's just grab an index card. If I want to apply gel medium through a stencil and I want to use an ink blending tool, I'm going to put some gel medium out and then I'm going to gradually pick some up on my ink. This was a brand new sponge. So I'm going to gradually pick some up because I don't want to overload it. And then it's just a matter of choosing a stencil. So this is our Elemental stencil and it's what you see here. Now I've cleaned it, whether or not it is clean enough so that the gel medium doesn't change color remains to be seen. But all I'm doing is tapping like this through the openings of a stencil. And that's going to give me, as I said, not perfect coverage, which is fine because it provides a very different finished look and feel. All right, so that's all you need to see. You can see the gel medium is glossy because it's shiny. Obviously, it will dry matte. So let's throw that out of the way. And then the last thing would be, let's take the same stencil. So let's bring that back. Let's take the same stencil, and this time I'm going to use the palette knife, and I'm going to grab more of the gel medium, and let's scoop that up. And this time I'm going to, well, scrape it through the openings of the stencil, which will result in a far better resist than what I just did. Although it kind of depends, well, there's a big old glob. It kind of depends on what you're attempting to accomplish. If you want a thicker layer and you want a more perfect resist, then this is the way to do it. So you can see there's quite a bit more on here than there was on the one that I showed you a second ago. All right, so let's take this dirty stencil and push it out of the way. And remember, gel medium is permanent when it's dry, so I'm gonna, when I get through filming this segment, I'm gonna take this over to the sink and go ahead and rinse all that gel medium off. Otherwise, you have some kind of an embellishment because you're not gonna be able to use it for much else. Okay, so coming back to the ones that are already done. This one has had gel medium applied through the openings of a stencil using the ink blending tool. So I'm gonna spray, I have Cracked Pistachio and Twisted Citron from Tim Holtz's line. I'm gonna just clean this up just to get it out of the way. All right, so that was a dirty paper towel, good grief. And what I'm gonna do now is grab a clean paper towel and go ahead and wipe this off. So you can see the gel medium acting as a resist, works really well, but as I said, you're not gonna have perfect coverage. It depends on the final look that you're trying to achieve. If I come back to the one, let's do this one and let's use the Cracked Pistachio. If I do this and I come back and I do the same kind of wipey wipe thing, you're going to see the design of the stencil has remained the color that it was to start with because the gel medium is permanent and it hasn't allowed any change. If I come through and I take this one and let's grab some different colors. This is milled lavender. If I take some different colors, this is actually a brand new bottle, and I spray this on here and let's come in with some of the tumble glass. If I do the same thing, and I am going to grab another piece of paper towel. If I do the same thing, let's start by wiping this up. You'll see that the areas where there was no gel medium have become colored with the milled lavender and the twisted citron. And if I think that this has gotten to be a little bit too light, I can come in and add some other colors. But what's important to note here is that because this was a thick layer of gel medium applied through the openings of the stencil, what I have is really good resist going on here. Now, what you see here, this is stuff that was on there. This was a print from a gel press plate. I picked up a bunch of stuff that was left. I didn't get everything, but the gel medium went on top of all of these, and that's why they have remained the way that they did. So there's so many different things that you can do, up to and including, if you want, let's just grab one more. If you want to put some colors on, and I'm just going to use what I have here, if you want to put some colors on like this and simply use this as your background, maybe add some layers with a stencil or maybe ghost a little bit, I can dry this. All of these things, all of these are possibilities. All of these are ways that you can go ahead and add color to these index cards so that you can assemble them into that wonderful journal that I showed you in the very beginning of the video.